Hi! Today, I would like to present to you a number of oscilloscopes that can be used to repair car electronics. One of the more basic ones is a 20 MHz pen-type oscilloscope. Then we have a 4-channel Hantech oscilloscope, which is suitable for car electronics. A stationary 2-channel 100 MHz oscilloscope. And a Siglent oscilloscope, which functions I will present today. The following additional items are part of the whole oscilloscope set: 2 multimeter probes, alligator clip set, 2 adapters, a 10 amper and a 600 milliamper, 2 oscilloscope probes, a flat screwdriver for probe compensation, and hook clips for precise measurements. Adjusting oscilloscope probe compensation. First, we need to connect the probes to the oscilloscope. And set the switch to X10. On the side panel of the oscilloscope, there is a 1 kHz square wave generator to which we can connect the probes for compensating. Press Auto Setup to select appropriate settings. Now, we can see that the probe is correctly adjusted. If not, use the included screwdriver to adjust the compensation so that the peaks of the waveforms are flat. Now, we have to repeat the procedure for the other probe. These buttons can be used to set the vertical scale of a given channel. Channel 2 currently has 1 volt, 2 volt, 5 volt. This button can be used to adjust the vertical position of the current channel waveform. These buttons can be used to adjust the horizontal time base. Pressing the S button increases the time base. Pressing the NS button decreases the time base. And these buttons adjust the horizontal position to the left or to the right. If we want to reset the offset, press Shift and the up arrow button. If we want to reset the horizontal delay to 0, press Shift and the left arrow button. We'll have to repeat the same steps for the other channel. Single function buttons. Now, let's focus on single function buttons. The first one is Acquire. This button lets us set the acquisition mode, memory depth, wave interpolation, and so on. The next button, Display, is used to enter the display menu, where we can, for example, change the vector to a dot, and so on. The third button, Utility, allows us to enter the menu where we can look at the system status, set the sound, language, do self-calibration, set date and time, check updates, and so on. The Run Stop button allows us to start or stop the acquisition. In Stop State, the key is illuminated in red. In Run State, the key is illuminated in yellow. Pressing the Auto Setup button enables the waveform auto-setting function. The oscilloscope will automatically adjust the vertical scale, horizontal time base, and trigger mode according to the input signal to realize optimum waveform display. Press the Default button to reset the oscilloscope to user default setup. This device also contains the following three buttons: Scope, Multimeter, and Recorder. Pressing the first one will start the scope functions of the oscilloscope. Pressing the second button will enable us to measure the AC and DC voltage, resistance, diode, continuity, capacitor, as well as AC and DC consumption. If we want to make advanced calculations of the oscilloscope signal, the device contains some mathematical functions that we can set so that various math operations are presented. This button lets us set the cursors in case we want to measure the time of a particular signal. The print button is used to save the data into a file. The menu off button turns the menu display on or off. The zoom and clear sweeps buttons. The trigger function allows for the signal release on the oscilloscope. Using a precise hook clamp, we can connect to one of the memory legs. I'll set 2 volts, time, 10 milliseconds, and I'll switch the power on. There was a signal for a moment. In order to determine a particular signal, let's change the mode from auto to single. Now, we'll use the knob to set the level to 1.5 volts. Let's turn the power on. And now the oscilloscope has determined a very brief signal that we can now move. Zoom in and analyze. Now, let's perform a 5P08 memory signal analysis. We'll connect hookups on legs 2 and 5 of the memory. I have a trigger function turned on, and the mode is set to single. Let's set the voltage to 5 volts and the time to 200 milliseconds for both channels, and let's turn on the power. Channel 1 is input data. Channel 2 is output data. We don't have to know the data itself. When we can see that the signals are showing up, we can be sure that the memory is working and exchanging information with the processor. Otherwise, we would either see only one of the channels working correctly, or there would be no input data in case of damage to the processor. The signal analysis on CAN transducer. Let's connect a precise hook clip to the first leg of the component and check for the signal. Then let's connect another hook clip to the fourth memory leg and check for the signal again. Now we're able to determine if the CAN signal is transmitted correctly from the ECU. Let's turn our attention to decoding the CAN signal, which means checking for a correct signal from the ECU that's connected on the table. It's very important to hold the probe by the BNC plug in order not to damage the rotating part. We'll insert both probes to the BNC sockets. Each socket has a corresponding color. Now, let's press the scope button. After turning the power on, we can see a signal that is not a CAN signal. And now it is. Why is that? It's because when the ECU is connected on the table, it needs to have a 120 ohm resistor between CAN low and CAN high in order to trigger a signal. Correct CAN signal decoding. Let's press Shift and print. The source is CAN high, which will be decoded. Set the threshold to 3.3 volts so that the horizontal line is on the visible signal, otherwise the signal will not be decoded. Now we're going to set the baud rate to 500 kilobits per second. If we set it, for example, to 250 kilobits per second, the signal will not be decoded properly. After setting the transmission correctly, we'll see accurate ID values. Underneath the list and the graphs, we can see CAN IDs running in real time. That way, we can check if the CAN in the ECU is working correctly. Of course, this was a very unusual situation. When the 120 ohm resistor between CAN lines is disconnected, then the signal looks like this. When I turn it back on, it is now correct. Conclusion. This type of oscilloscope is a necessary tool that can assist in our work. We can use it as an oscilloscope, as a regular multimeter to check the voltage, power consumption, resistance, and we can use it to decode CAN bus or SPI signals in order to check if a customer's ECU is working correctly and whether we can install Julie emulator in the ECU.
Thanks for watching this video. Leave a like and subscribe to CarLabImmo Technical Channel.